Arcanax login confirmed.
Welcome to the Lodge. You've accessed
the LodgeCast experience.
Warning, warning. Dangerous spoilers ahead. Enjoy.
When the Arcanax login is confirmed and the theme song kicks in, we go somewhere we've never been before. Not just entertained, but reborn together. Dazzling hot takes and bone counts I can feel. Somehow, Glenn Danzig's films feel good on a podcast like this. Our hosts feel like the best part of us, and live rewrites feel perfect and powerful. Because here, they are. Metz Movie Lodgecast. We make movie podcasts better.
The Lodgecast is a little podcast where we watch weird movies so you don't have to.
The Lodgecast, baby.
Lodgecast, gonna smoke this. Lodgecast, listen, movie pass. Lodgecast.
We're gonna watch some crap.
Lodgecast.
And then the Lodge Master chats
with Lucas
and Bishki.
Episode 128, Men.
Hello and welcome to a mentastic episode of the Lodgecast. I'm your Lodge Master. With me as always is Brother Bishki.
Hey, mate.
We got Brother Lucas in the way back.
Good evening.
And you know, if Brother Lucas is in the way back, we got an extra packed special episode. We got returning champion, Brother Justin.
Here to do some serious mansplaining, Lodge Master.
He's the token man. We got Lodge Mistress Millie.
Hello, hello, hello.
And for the first time, the stupendously cool first-time guest, long-time listener, Sister Cargies is here.
Hey, hey, my pleasure.
We are all here tonight to see a new film called Men. M-E-N. That's what it's called.
Like the men's room.
Like the men's room. And it is the new film from director Alex Garland.
Oh!
Who we won't get into it tonight, but he is very contentious among Lodge casters.
Annihilation might be the most contentious film amongst the Lodge. Like it's,
we
it's,
fight it, all the time about it. Just yeah. Bringing it up makes us battle. And the battle lines have been drawn.
Yeah.
We've promised a Royal Rumble episode for years. I don't know if it's going to happen.
Just so I can see where the battle lines are, is there any Annihilation fans in the car other than me? Anyone like...
Remind me what it's about?
Yeah.
Natalie Portman. Did anyone see
it? Oh, I didn't see it.
Yeah, no one saw it? Didn't see it?
Okay. A tumbleweed just went by okay. In the car.
Ambivalent.
I was trying to get Nate with me, but he...
Nope. You're alone, Bishki.
All right. So I love Alex Garland. I love Ex Machina's 4 bones. Annihilation's 3.5 bones. And I'm very excited for Men.
Ex Machina's cool. So I am kind of at a neutral plane for this. Now, Sister Cargies, do you know anything about this movie?
I saw the trailer. I'm a fan of the lead actress on her, you know, all of her accomplishments. And I have to say, I'm in the right frame of mind to watch a film like this tonight.
Nice. And Lodge Mistress Millie, do you know anything about this?
I'm right with Sister Cargies on this. I love me some Jessie Buckley. And I'm excited always for a horror film, so I'm pumped.
Yeah, let's talk about that. So going into a horror movie, does that weigh your ratings at all? If there is there different expectations?
Personally, I'm always more excited, but like probably the bones are going to go down because I have high expectations
high
for
standards.
Horror. And even though horror usually has low expectations when it comes to Rotten Tomatoes, if the ending's good, they give it a high rating, but not so much with me. I need it to be good throughout.
That's true. If a horror movie ends well, the tomatoes spike.
They do.
It's always the case.
Yeah, but the problem is Alex Garland is all set up and no payoff.
The hothead is already... Wow. The heat is just
heat, coming hot.
Were you like, just emanating
from there? Were you knocking Ex Machina?
Like The Beach, like 28 Days Later, and yes, like Annihilation and Ex Machina. The first half is great, and the second half is bleh.
Okay, the hothead's already hot. Brother Justin, what are you bringing to this?
I think Alex is a prolific screenwriter. Mm-hmm. And yeah. also, because I'll never have another opportunity to plug this, wrote an amazing game called Enslaved Odyssey to the West that was available on the PlayStation 3.
Wow.
Fantastic
Thank
game.
Thank you for telling us
Really
that.
Well written.
You'll only hear about that here, folks.
Hot tip. But I'm kind of with Brother Lucas in that there's a lot of fantastic premise, fantastic setup, and ending. Specifically with his latest endeavor, Devs, that limited series, Agreed. Which I thought was pretty fantastic early on, and then perplexingly terrible at the end.
Bishke, you got your work cut out for
I was tempted on Devs, but I did not
You're going to have to fight hard if it's this thing goes south.
It's Duh Alley G Show.
It's discount night.
It is discount night!
Discount night!
Now, Sister Cargis, have you ever knowingly been to a discount night at the AMC 16?
Probably so, but not knowingly. I mean, I think I've wandered in. I've tiptoed in, which is very much what I'm doing in the horror genre tonight.
Yes.
Like, I'm not a body horror type. Like my example of my frame of reference is like, ooh, Wicker Man, which I have to say, when I saw the trailer,
the Nicolas
I was like,
Cage version, right?
No, but the silly, you know, these crazy maniacal velociraptor grins that are coming out of these men did actually echo what I saw. So I'm curious to see how this is going to play out.
Well, I mean, all signs point to this being quote unquote elevated horror. And there's a lot of think pieces already saying horror is back. There's a lot of hype around this, so I'm excited. Is anybody going to MacGuffin's tonight to get some libations for this?
Yard House was my MacGuffin's, man. I'm set to go.
You pre-MacGuffin's, which equals 1 yard.
You pre-MacGuffin's at the Yard House. That's smart.
If there's a men-themed drink, I will get it.
Nice, Justin.
If they're all Doctor Strange, no deal.
Well, let's see if men will ice down the hot, hot heart of the hothead in the way back.
No way.
We'll see how we all fall. We'll see if Bishke has to dance for his supper tonight.
Yeah, Iceman coming for you. Let's do this.
Let's climb them steps, y'all. Love and light.
Love and light.
Love and light.
It's rising.
We just saw men, hallelujah. We just saw men, amen. Everybody still with us? Everybody alive?
Oh, yep. Yeah.
Yep. Alive.
Split in two.
Split up.
One arm.
Oh my God. Well, before we get into it.
Bishke, what's that shot?
From Rotten Tomatoes. In the aftermath of a personal tragedy, Harper, Jessie Buckley, retreats alone to the beautiful English countryside, hoping to have found a place to heal. But someone or something from the surrounding woods appears to be stalking her. What begins as simmering dread becomes a fully formed nightmare inhabited by her darkest memories and fears in visionary filmmaker Alex Garland's Ex Machina Annihilation, feverish, shape-shifting new horror film, period.
Oh, Bishki, you got your work cut out for you. But before we jump into it, there's something about these A24 movies. The audience is primed for Kidman.
Yeah.
They are ready. And they are ready.
It's an A24 meme, almost.
They are ready to burst. I heard the dude behind me was like, you know, after it shows the AMC popcorn guy and all that, he's just like, puddle, please, puddle, puddle, puddle.
Puddle. There was a call for the puddle.
And then it cuts to the puddle and people went ape shit. They all chimed in with Heartbreak Feels Good in a Place Like This. And it was rapturous applause. Mm-hmm. And then it's instantly dumped into an austere film. And they all know to shut the fuck up.
And it's, and it's silenced throughout.
It's amazing. It's like a conductor just like brought their hand together into a fist.
Yeah.
And then they know how to fucking behave.
Yeah.
It's great.
I will say, just on the A24 thing, and I don't know, maybe this is the thing for the movie that we saw, but there were so many, it felt like this onslaught of A24 merchandising.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh no, I had a wince of going, oh shit, are they not cool anymore? Like when like when gangster rap started to sell shit to like McDonald's to the suburbs or something, you're like, oh no, this is maybe not a good thing.
It's too fucked out.
Yeah.
No. You didn't like those Dr. Dre Happy Meals in the late 90s? That's when I started.
Well, I just know
listen.
I literally bought an Ice Cube shirt at Target this morning for my kid, and I was like, "Oh no, this is the equivalent, perhaps."
In 10 years, it's going to be a men shirt, pre-distressed.
It's
The merch is dangerous with A24 because you can start to see where they're sprinkling it into their films.
Oh, like, yeah, and the snail trailer was like, "Well, okay."
Yeah,
we'll see.
Bishki, do you think A24 is fucked out?
Well. You know, I'm not married to any filmmaker. I'll turn my back on anyone.
Spoken like a man.
Uh-oh. We'll see.
She's solidly Team Marvel now. You heard it here first, folks.
So, men, and Lodge Mistress, you can attest to this. Mm. The log line in the description about retreating to the countryside after a tragedy, that's pure Lifetime movie setup. And those are the movies that we would skip. We skip those as a rule. We're like, that's just going to be creeping around a house.
Single female romping.
Griefing around a house.
Yeah.
And it's the same setup, but there's different artistry you can bring to it, you know? So I was a little worried at first. But you know, the movie looks good, right?
Looks great.
Yeah?
No, I like the setup. I was thinking more like, because it's Alex Garland. He's not bringing Lifetime to it.
No.
I was thinking more like Straw Dogs.
Exactly. Yeah,
like,
same.
Like, you know, but with the female by herself perspective and dealing with that. So my hopes were high at first.
How do we feel in The Edge about dealing with grief movies?
I'm over it.
The voice echoes out from the back.
Good acting and good aesthetic can take a walk. Good riddance. I don't give a fuck.
Oh, no.
Fuck.
He's on fire, y'all.
I care about a good story. Yeah. But good acting and good aesthetic are secondary to a good story.
True.
All right. If you want to know how to get over grief, you drink 2 whalebone beers like someone at a bachelorette party in Vegas before the movie.
That's true. Yeah, that'll help.
But like, it also is like a sort of a not ever true in the movies. Like, yeah, it's the people don't grieve like that. It's like they ain't got time to grieve like that. You know, it's like all these people just got time to do nothing, sit around, stare, and think.
Well, she's not grieving anything because obviously the man she's trying to divorce was holding her hostage by her emotions. So it's not like
didn't feel that complicated.
Yeah, I don't think she was grieving anything.
Yeah, she
real
kind
red
of
herring for just a reason for her to be encountering.
Yeah.
The concept of men in various forms that all look the same for a reason because they're all embodying the same characteristics of, you know.
Yeah, but she herself kind of has it figured out from the get-go. She just needs to get away and get some fresh air. and we get that long walk in the woods where she's pleased for a minute, then yeah, the men all fuck it up for her. But she's not grappling with anything, really. She's just...
It's one node from start to finish.
I agree.
Yeah. No,
I did get bored frequently.
This movie is like Garden State and that they're both just a trailer.
Wow.
Damn.
Hothead's heating up. Bishki, are you going to... I mean, you're the man. You got to defend this shit. What's the hothead talking about?
No,
he just invoked Zach Braff.
The thing I like about Alex Garland is he's an ideas guy. And yeah. Ex Machina and Annihilation for me were full of interesting ideas
yeah.
that he was exploring. This one is so thin.
It's thin.
It's a wisp.
It's a home invasion movie, basically.
It's a dandelion spore floating in the dogs.
It's an art house. Yeah. It's an art house. Home invasion straw dogs set up, but it's just one note. It is one note.
Well, with a real Cronenberg fly pregnant sort mm-hmm. of and it's scenario. And
the imagery, like, I don't know who to blame, like Ari Aster maybe?
Because, yes.
Because the imagery is just kind of like, what the fuck? And it's not serving any story, really. It's just kind of like...
Well, and the story, you could tell it in 3 minutes.
Yeah.
It's film school 101.
It's a short film and not even.
I would say it's grad school. Yeah, I'll give it a little more credit than that. But I agree with Millie that it did feel like a short film in a lot of ways. I personally was engaged throughout, even the one-notedness of it that we're all railing on. I was still pretty locked in for the most part. And I think it's interesting evoking Ari Aster because there's a lot of imagery in his movies, but I never feel like I need to have read up on the subjects before I go to the theater.
Right.
Whereas this, there was a lot of stuff that I was trying to reach into my brain.
Yep.
Like, did right. I not pay attention yeah. in Sunday school
well,
to know what the stone imagery in the church is and why the guy's trying to turn into it?
And
it, my own ignorance kind of factors into it a little bit where it's kind of, I feel like it that almost makes it condescending.
Well, and... At a certain point, when they're not giving you any sort of breadcrumbs at all anymore, it kind of feels like the director's saying, you figure it out.
Yeah.
The film lives inside of you, and the discussion is yeah. my masturbatory
or
joy.
Like, oh, you're not familiar with this old English fable? Well, fuck you, idiot.
It was like The Green Man, right?
Yeah.
I don't remember what The Green Man was.
Nobody does. But to me, that speaks on a larger issue, which as a supposed horror film, once a movie becomes more symbolic than concrete, the scares go away because mm-hmm. you're like...
Yeah, I was never scared.
Flat as fuck.
You're like, anything can happen. It's like somebody explaining a dream to you. The craziest shit could happen.
The most boring.
It could be
experience.
Like, you know, the monkey put on a top hat and then started doing the Macarena and you're yawning. You're like, I don't care because anything can happen and nothing matters.
Yeah, right. Yeah. It's not grounded in anything. Like initially it was a little grounded.
And the audience was fucking locked in.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was strange.
Laughing like, all over the place like they were lobotomized.
But then does the monkey...
Hashtag lobotomized.
I was laughing, but it wasn't an engaged laugh. It was like
but then the monkey with the top hat gets his arm cut in half vertically. And
I mean, that was interesting. And all the incarnations had that, which was cool when it harkened back to her husband. But, I mean...
You want it to be like inside her head or she's going insane, but she's reacting to everything like a sane person would.
Yeah.
So that doesn't.
She never really evolved. She was like pretty sane with her husband when she was like, no, you got to go. And then she was pretty sane when the priest was like, you're to blame. She's like, no, I'm not.
Fuck you.
So yeah, like her arc was pretty non-existent.
Exactly. She mm-hmm. had it all figured out. She just needed to clear her head.
Do you think. Part of the problem is that it's a story of a woman's grief written from a man's
yes.
perspective. So there's overcompensation with how she deals with things because a man in the 21st century, especially post Me Too, wouldn't want to portray too much weakness as a, you know, a reaction to grief.
Well, that was...
So is it overcompensation?
Most definitely. I mean, that was my take on it. And when I was laughing audibly, it was because I was considering the fact that a man made this movie called Men, and especially in the birth scenes, I mean, but as a person that's given birth, you know, a couple times, it was really, really fucking funny to
hold that thought.
Times in a row in rapid
succession. Hold that thought. We got to summon the motherfucking salad dragon.
The Salad Dragon. A scene in a movie that is so bizarre, baffling, or transcendent that it instantly justifies the price of admission. Or Reese Witherspoon's leafy transformation in A Wrinkle in Time.
We got a salad man here.
We got like a 20-minute salad.
Salad man. Yeah.
Unbelievable. Yeah.
So
we went to Ponderosa.
Golden Corral.
So, Sister Cargis, do you want to attempt to explain what happens in this Salad Dragon suite?
Well, I mean, it was, you know.
The men have surrounded her home.
The men have descended en masse.
And all the men are played by the same men.
All the men are played by the same men, recalling the same injuries and the same sort of foreboding. You know, they're laying all the same shit on her as every man in her life, apparently. Then they all proceed to sort of one after the other have this very Goldblum fly-esque birthing of one another in full form, which was kind of cool. But as a, you know, like I said, as a person that has actually given birth a couple times, it was really hilarious to me to get the just the dude perspective of like how that might look. And then this one, is this a spoiler situation? I mean, when the feet come out of the mouth, I was actually won over. I was so laughing.
I heard
And then when that happened, it was like, oh, okay. So, okay. Maybe there's something more here that I'm missing. There's some depth because clearly this is so fucking absurd.
I mean,
that like
the audience was losing it because they were adrift in this movie at this point.
I mean, I was constantly looking for a life raft. I mean, it was not adrift.
There was no story. There was no story.
So when we get to this multi-birthing suite where the green man births a young boy with a man's face digitally grafted onto his face, who is also pregnant, coming out of his ass. And you're in discount night at the Burbank AMC 16 on maybe a date night. People were just
eating it up.
They were laughing the laugh of the insane person. Mm-hmm. They were just like, huh. And before that, there were a lot of sighs. I heard some deep Lucas-esque sighs just from the general audience. Just like, oh, and then you see an Apple Watch illuminate, you know? So at least they got something for their troubles.
Yeah, that's true.
You know?
Yeah.
But again, it's in service of...
I'm not sure.
What? Like,
I guess it's supposed to be like this whole cycle of like life, death, birth, that deer disintegrating, and maybe that's kind of beautiful. I don't know.
It's half-baked.
Half-baked. Half-baked. Was her friend pregnant?
Yeah, yes. She was. She did not just eat a burrito. She was pregnant. The and nachos then,
and
that we had.
Did you get the impression it was a boy?
Yeah.
I was kind of thinking like, oh, men are fucked up, whatever. But then they always sort of start from this place of like being born from a woman.
Right. And helpless. Just like, help me.
It was so half-baked.
Yeah.
I thought there were some good scenes.
Tell.
Yeah, like for a trailer, right, Bishke?
Yeah, no, the imagery was good, but the, I don't know, just her and her husband, those scenes were, I don't know, emotionally.
Yeah, those were good.
Those were fully fleshed out scenes.
Had some weight, and had the other half of the movie been at all interesting, like they could have.
It seemed like having the same man play all the characters. I mean, it was funny, but it felt like a parlor trick after a while. It's like when Michael Keaton was in Multiplicity.
Yeah.
It's like you did it because you could.
Yeah, it's a gimmick.
You know?
Stretched thin.
All right. Hold
on. I'll defend. Hold on. I will defend Multiplicity. Yeah.
I wasn't going there. Oh, but.
I'm with you. I will defend it.
I'm going to inject some love and light and say that. I thought Rory Kinnear was pretty extraordinary.
He's amazing.
I think in every role, even the digi teenager, his head on a kid's body.
Digi ragamuffin?
Still did a court? Pretty compelling job in conveying different,
different characters,
different, serving different parts of the story. And even though it is half-baked, I think even Jessie Buckley's performance was pretty fantastic.
Oh, she's great.
Yeah.
Acting was great.
She's the best very part likeable, of every movie, though, right?
And that actor is in Penny Dreadful, and I gotta say, he plays like the Frankenstein character. He is amazing in that show, and the writing in that show is so good. I highly recommend it.
Yeah,
highly recommend it.
I would like the writing to meet his talent and his efforts.
Mm-hmm. If I remember right, he was also Prime Minister Pigfucker in Black.
Yes, that was his peak.
He didn't really have any characters to dig into, though. He didn't have any really good. He never really went anywhere. No. You know, his scenes, they were also sort of surface and over, just very like heavy-handedly metaphorical.
Yeah.
Hey, maybe I'm missing something, but because there was like a lack of actual scenes in the film, but when she sort of lies about playing piano and then sits down and plays like Chopin or something. Was that supposed to be something monumental? thinking that
she didn't
going
want to like pander to the guy,
or she didn't.
I don't know.
She's
weird.
She's protective and gun shy about opening up to anybody. Maybe.
Okay.
I don't know. I mean, there's so little to go on.
It's table slow. Scraps, really.
And was her friend American?
I think so. Mm-hmm.
And I kept thinking, like, how do they meet? Like, I don't know.
And the cell phone interference that.
That's not good.
That she kept getting. I mean, when she kept losing touch with her friend, and you see
interesting technology that didn't really sync up with 2022 in terms of how that sort of
you see in the static like
very broken,
like some sort of Nine Inch Nails video, like in the static.
That's not how FaceTime works.
That's not how it works. Yeah, I was also like,
Justin and I both kind of made the same technological grunt at that point.
It just like goes gray or it freezes.
And you see a face. Lucas, any other thoughts back there? Did you stay awake?
Yeah, I stayed awake, but I couldn't believe how many people were laughing in the theater. I almost wanted to laugh back, like mockingly, just to make them feel like fucking idiots.
Lucas wanted mocking to mock it.
Damn it.
Mocking us. <Beat you. laughs>
Wasn't good, but I beat you.
That's why you're the Lodge Master.
Yeah, I mean, the scene where one of the men or all of the men are reaching their hand through the mail slot. And she stabs her knife through the arm.
Yeah.
And then the hand slowly withdraws, which just fillets the arm up and then between the fingers, causing this floppy split hand arm scenario.
Prong, yeah.
Yes.
Cool.
That's a crouton. Solid
crouton. It's a crouton. Crouton certified.
And her husband's arm has been slit by that railing.
Yes.
But the other thing that was kind of amazing, it was maybe a little sexy, was when he encircled her with his split hand.
Yes. When the priest
was it sexy, Amy?
It was a tiny bit sexy because I was like, what's happening on this scene?
Yes. When the priest.
A bit of a strangle. She was kind of into it. You weren't sure.
She was into
it. When the priest reaches for her, we cut to behind her. And we see two fingers on each side of her neck just kind of resting on her shoulders and gripping her. And it's quite the shot. I mean, there are fucking shots in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But shots a movie does not make.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And also good luck at home, guys, trying to fulfill those weird fantasies that have now been created. I wish you the best.
It's going to be painful.
It's a Halloween prosthetic situation.
It's going to take a weird
quad arm. Yes.
Yeah. Oh.
It was, I will say, when the knife thing happened, I was like, I was sitting next to you, Lucas, and laughing my ass off, but for probably different, it was... At that point, I was so bored that it was entertaining.
Yeah, we were laughing at it.
It was a very at, not
if
with.
If anyone thinks that was intentionally supposed to be funny, like it's just.
It was so funny, but
come on.
It's wild. Wild laugh.
Some of those were very intentional.
Nervous
laughs.
Laughter.
A lot of that.
Nervous laughter.
I never felt on the edge of my seat or anything. It was very comical. But after that, it was like, oh, that was cool. That was a cool trick. okay, now it's a cool device. Oh God, now it's a gimmick. Yes. And we are in this broken arm thing for 30 fucking minutes.
You're so right. Yeah.
Okay. How many more times are, and you know, cinematic as it may have been.
Let's go to the men bones.
The bones on men.
All right, Sister Cargis, you are first to bone.
Oh, no.
First to bone.
I need to remember the four bones is good. Four is good.
If you need a refresher, four bones is great. Woof is trouble.
Woof is bad.
I'm going to give it a one bone for those two folk songs at the top and the end. And I really obsessed about most of the movie going, is this Vashti Bunyan? Is it, who are we listening to? And then it's a cover by a man, I think. So, in the costuming, maybe. I'll give it a one.
Drop a one bone on it.
Yeah.
One bone from Sister Cargis for selected musical tracks in the costumes, maybe.
Maybe.
Woo. Brother Bishki.
Disappointed.
Uh-oh.
Garland. Come on, man.
Welcome to the club.
Jesus.
No, I was a big fan coming in, but I would turn my back on anyone.
It's ice cold.
No loyalty.
The ice man.
And I'm not turning my back for life. You get three tries. You get three strikes and you're out. But so I'll go back with you to the drawing board, but you gotta put more into it, man. You gotta really get the ideas cooking. And I would stick with sci-fi. The creepy horror, the half-baked kind of creepy home invasion stuff. Like, no, go big, go sci-fi, bigger ideas, good performances, well shot. Not the worst thing I've seen all year. Two bones
from Brother Bishki, laying it out. He's disappointed, Alex. Let's step it up. Lodge Mistress Millie.
Yeah, I know. It's like...
I looked over you when the credits rolled and I've assessed... I'm like, oof.
I never can go too low, though, when the acting is that good.
And when there's Brits about.
And I think she was Irish in this.
It sounded pretty Irish.
So, yeah. I mean, I love her. I love the dude. I thought there was some really amazing sort of visual shots. It was so boring.
Yeah.
But I just I don't think I can go lower than two because the acting is
good. There you go. I'm gonna give it two. There you go. You like a little boredom here and there.
Mm.
But not like this.
Mm-mm.
Not like this. All right.
It's a reluctant two. I just got to say that.
Reluctant two. It's a shaky two.
Yeah.
Strategically, we're going all the way back. Brother Lucas, what are you going to do to this?
Yeah. When I saw the trailer, I thought, wow, this looks interesting. Sign me up. Great trailer.
We signed you up.
And then as we were walking into the theater, I told myself, please God, just this once, don't let this Alex Garland movie be just a trailer. Let it be more than a trailer. Give me something.
You prayed to the green man.
Some hook to hang my hat on, some meat on the bone, some scenery to chew.
There was some meat.
Give me something I have not seen in the trailer already. Give me one thing.
Mm.
I have not seen in the trailer already.
They gave you the split hands?
Yeah.
But alas.
The birthings.
Everything I saw was in the trailer with the exception of those two things, which, you know what, didn't really pay off or add up to much because you're right, there's no story here.
Mm.
This is a film school edgelord 101 bullshit.
Is it student future certified?
And I give it a Roger Ebert Memorial half bone.
Oh, shit. Wow.
I hated this movie.
Roger Ebert Memorial Halfbone. He didn't go woof, though. There's hope.
Because he's sniffing around the right dirt pile. He just needs to fucking have a co-writer or a producer to help him flesh it out.
Yeah.
Preferably a woman. Thank you very much.
Whoa, there you go. Praise be to Lucas. Brother Justin,
I
love and light?
I wouldn't go that far. I think a man in 2022 is still capable of writing a good movie, you guys.
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm in the multiverse of madness right now because I think I was twice as enthralled by this movie as everyone else in the car.
Yes, let us have it.
You know, occasionally I see something that is abstract and I embrace that. And sometimes you can interpret that as shallowness. But I think some movies coast on a vibe And this is one of them.
Sure.
And I think it kind of surfed on the top of that vibe successfully for me. So I'll forgive its shallowness and I'll forgive the snootiness of needing some book learning beforehand. If that's what I needed to get depth out of it, because that ain't going to happen for me.
No way.
But I was pretty locked in for the most part. Most of the laughs that got out of me were genuine. I was not laughing at it. I was getting the jokes that this movie was throwing at me.
Mm-hmm.
And it has been a very long time since I've walked out of a theater very confused, but thinking, is it my fault?
Right.
You know, because most of the time when you walk out going, huh, I didn't really get that, it's definitely the writer's fault.
Right.
This time, I don't know. Maybe it's me. So
it's not you, Justin.
You don't know that.
I do know.
You
don't
know that. You don't know what kind of RPMs I'm working with in my brain.
I know you well enough to know, but anywho's.
So anyway, I found this much more enjoyable than the rest of y'all. I'm not going to quite go as high as three bones. That's ludicrous. I'm going 2.5.
All right. Mm-hmm. 2.5. Mm-hmm. Good. That's spread. Good. It's a good spread. I'm not going to break the mold here. I found it boring, just like everybody, but I also found it, you know, I found there to be enough to chew on, like Justin did, that I had a good time. And I definitely sat forward a few times just to get a closer look at the various birthing canals.
Yeah.
I was very interested in that. But I don't think I can go up to 2.5. I think I'm feeling good coasting on that too, but it's a warm two. It's warmer. It's a warmer two than the Lodge Mistress's shaky two.
It's just a warm deuce is what you say.
It's a nice warm
temperature
deuce that we dropped. So that's men, y'all.
If the Lodge debate series ever happens, I do want to fight about Annihilation.
We'll still fight about Annihilation.
Okay. Now, just so we get this right, are we physically fighting about Annihilation?
Fighting to the death.
I'll do some wrestling. Bring in the resident bad boy. I will wrestle him.
We'll fight. We'll see if that ever happens.
I'm looking up Green Man as soon as we get off.
Mm. Yes, excellent. Sister Cargis, this was your first hell foray.
Yeah, really.
thank
went
you.
Right into the deep end here. Thank you so much for this pleasurable experience.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, the I just keep going back to the birthing scene. I'm like, it's, you know, tropey to be like, what if Margaret Atwood had shot this? Yeah, how would that look? And then I'm like, is this what dudes see when they see this? Is this their perception of like, holy shit, the thing is, it's just so fascinating. So I was full of mirth during that whole time.
I hope it makes its way into your dreams tonight.
It will.
Brother Justin, thank you for joining and having a good confusing time. Lodge Mistress Millie, pleasure as always. Yep. Oh, look out for those men, y'all. They're coming for you.
It's raining men.
It's birth and man.
It's birth and man, y'all.
It should have been called Scroop or whatever he called stealing apples was.
That's right. Alex Garland presents Scroop.
Scroop.
Love and light, y'all.
Love and light.
I was talking to my girlfriend just the other day. I was not a bit surprised at what she had to say. On the subject of love, we both were disillusioned. All day long we tried to find some kind of a solution. She said, I'm tired of all that cheating and lying.
this is maybe not a good thing.